am I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Well, not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean.
To ever since on, will wipe our eyes dry, take us up to his side, and forever we will be his. Singing blessing and honor and glory and power forever to our God. Singing blessing and honor and glory and power forever to our God.
getting back into our series that we started last year. Can't believe it's been a whole year. Alright. We went through the whole series on Follow Me from Matthew 5 through 7. And we talked about what it really meant to follow Christ, to be a disciple, to be a Christian. And then we moved from that into this series called Christ and Culture. And we're looking at some of the topics, some of the discussion points that this world has, where we can take all of the theoretical and the practical things that we've learned in Matthew 5 through 7 and put them into practice. The reality is we have a lot of opportunities in this world to practice being Christians. And please understand, it's practice being Christians, not perfect being Christians, because we're not quite there yet. We need all the practice. It's like doctors, they practice medicine. I'm looking for the doctor who's perfected it so I can get taken care of. That's the mindset that we've got to have. And I'm going to just be very open with you this morning and transparent. There are some topics that I know we need to talk about. We need to speak about these things from the pulpit, but also from the pews. And today is one of those topics. But they're difficult to do. I do not want to give this sermon today, and I do not want to give the two sermons that are coming in the next 2 weeks. Because what the Bible says on these topics, sanctity of human life today, and then in the next 2 weeks we're going to be looking at sexuality. What the Bible says on these topics is so far away from what culture says. Remember, with this series, we're looking at what culture says about it, what the Bible says about it, and how we should live in it. Culture tells us that there's a certain expectation, there's a certain level of what's right and wrong, and so many times, in so many areas, what the world says is at complete odds with what the Bible says. And it is very easy for the world to stand back and to call Christians who want to stand up and say, I believe in the sanctity of human life, or I believe in this or that, and to call us horrible things, hypocrites, haters, and all of those things. I don't like confrontation. Now, some of you may not believe that. My kids would probably disagree. But I really don't like confrontation. I'm kind of that warm, fuzzy, cuddly guy. At least I want to be. But there are times when we just have to stand up and we have to speak the truth. The reality is, I would rather stand before men and be called a hate monger than to stand before God and be told that I failed, and I didn't share the truth. Now, in these topics, I'm going to share the truth in love. I'm going to do everything that I can not to stand up here and just, you know, pummel people with God's word. We've seen that happen. We see how effective that is. It's not very effective, at least in the long term. My goal is to stand up here and to share with you what God's word says. And the awesome thing about God's word is much stronger, it's much greater, it's much more powerful than I will ever be. I'll let God's word speak for itself, and you can make that decision based on what God says. And then you can still take me out for Tim Hortons and be kind if you wish. Calendar's got some openings if you're interested. So this morning we're going to talk about the sanctity of human life. And most of the time this topic is really just narrowed in on the topic of abortion. We're going to speak to that today. But I also want to take you into a broader scope. If you haven't noticed, life covers a long period of time for many people. This morning I want to focus us on conception to death. It's interesting, I have a funeral to do this afternoon. So we're going to wrap up everything in one full day. This is a difficult discussion. I have not had to personally deal in any kind of a intimate level with abortion. But I have had to sit in a hospital room and have a discussion with a family who is watching a loved one, I mean, just suffer. And have them turn to me and say, Dan, is it wrong? Is euthanasia, mercy killing as it's called sometimes, is that wrong? And for me to sit there and struggle to really give not a biblical answer, I understand a biblical answer, but to put it into practice, that's hard. That's a difficult thing to do. And so please, as we walk through this, know my heart. I think you do. You know that my goal is for you to have a greater, more intimate relationship with God. And the greatest thing that I can do for anyone is to help you in that process of knowing God. So this morning, the sanctity of human life, what does culture say about it? I believe culture has a very low view of human life. Interesting statistics, and I'm not going to bore you with too many of these today, but here's an interesting one. By the time a child reaches the age of 18, they will have witnessed over 200,000 violent acts against people just on TV. Forget about it if you live in Chicago, okay? 200,000. I didn't take the time to break that down, you know, into a per minute thing, but it's got to be pretty high. And this isn't just fictional TV anymore. It's not the, you know, the hour-long dramas. You know, when I was a kid, nobody ever really died. Everybody had really bad aim. They were all like stormtroopers in training or something. But today, it's not just on those dramas. It's in the sitcoms. It's in the news shows. It's in the reality TV. Our music industry glorifies violence against women, against children, against fellow men. It has become almost expected that there would be violence in our world. That shows a very low value of human life. Let me go into the realm of abortion. A little graph, I'll step aside so you can see this better. This graph here. The last year that we have statistics was 2013, and that's that number at the right hand. In 2013, in the United States, 664,435 abortions were performed. Vast, 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 vast majority choice that was made. You see that other number, 1,429,247. That was 1990. That was an all-time high since abortion was legalized in the United States. Began in 1970. You add all of those numbers together, 43,963,070 abortions since 1969. That's just the United States. Let's go out there. Oh, by the way, these numbers, this isn't from a pro-life movement. This is the Center for Disease Control. Okay? This is their numbers. World Health Organization monitors things on a global scale. 224 million abortions just between 2010 and 2014. 56 million per year. On average, one out of four pregnancies ended in abortion. That blows the mind. I can't even begin to fathom. We could look at more and more statistics. But I don't think I need to convince anyone here today that society, culture, this world has a very low value of human life. I sat through a minister, and again, it was a man I respected, and he laid out on a day like today, Sanctity of Human Life Day, and he laid out all of these negatives, and just kind of, I mean, walked out of there, I felt just beat down, pictures and all of these things, and I don't want to do that to you. We understand, I hope, the seriousness of this issue. Human life isn't worth the amount of money you would get from recycling our parts in society today. Thankfully, I don't follow what society says. I follow what Christ says. And God has a very high value in your life. Take your Bibles, go to Genesis chapter 1. Easy to find, it's on page 1 of your pew Bible. Get past the index and you'll find it. Some of this is going to be old hat for some of you. I was looking through my notes. We went to Genesis 1 and 2 a lot last year. I guess we just really needed to be reminded of a couple of things. We're going to go to it right now. Genesis chapter 1 is the account of creation. And I'll just throw this out there. This is free. Yes, I do believe Genesis 1:1 in the following verses, that God created everything. In Genesis 1, he creates out of nothing. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. It wasn't like an Amazon Prime starter kit he purchased and used. It was out of nothing. It was God in his power. And by the time we get down to verse 25, we have a description of the creation of everything. The sun and the moon and the stars and the plants and the ice cream is in there somewhere, I'm certain. The dry land. And we get down to verse 26. And God creates man. Look at verse 26. Genesis 1, 26 and 27. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heaven, over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. Josh, turn this mic on, just a switch, would you? These verses here in 26 and 27 show us that mankind was made in a spectacular fashion. It says it was made in the image of God. That word image is the Hebrew word tselem, which means resemblance. Understand what that says. My relatives, this happened again when we went out to Iowa. My uncle comes over, and my cousins, and they all go, oh, you just resemble your father so much. I'm like, really? Because he was old. You're old? Do I? Don't answer that. He's my own son. I'm grounded. To say that man is made in the image of God means that we're modeled after him. Now listen, God is not a 40-something-year-old man who's slightly overweight, definitely balding. That's what I look like. That's not what God looks like. I look like his image. That word tselem has another meaning that's not used very often, and it's the word shadow. Think about that. I was in here the other day, and I just, when I'm in here walking around and working on my sermon, I have just one set of lights on. And I can stand right underneath this light, and I've got this nice shadow that looks much slimmer than I do. So I stand in that spot. That shadow has my shape, it has my form, it has my resemblance, but it does not have any of my attributes, right? I can look at that shadow and you know how many chins I see? One. Not this number. Some of you guys grew a beard to hide that. You're not fooling me. I can stand there and I look at the shadow, it has my shape, it has a resemblance to me, right? But it is not me. And so that word image is kind of that concept of a shadow. We are a shadow of God's image. We're made in his image. We are not God. And he doesn't look like us, but we're modeled after him. The other word we saw there was the word likeness. That's the Hebrew word dmut, which means shape or fashion. Again, just reinforcing the image of God. That same word is used when we read in the prophets about idols. And they would take a trunk of a tree and make a carved image. It was in the likeness. So it portrayed something that you recognized, that you knew, but it wasn't that thing, okay? So God created man in his own image. It's a high value. How many of you have ever made something like a wood shop or anything like that? Anybody? I've made a couple of things, more than just peanut butter pie. I made my mom a chair one year, and every year when I go out to Iowa, you know what? I want to see where that chair is. I want to see how it is. I take pride in that image. That chair is worthless to everyone else, but to me, it's got a high value. Hopefully, to my mom as well. That's what we're talking about. Now, jump down to verse 31, because I want you to see just how high our value is in God's eyes. Verse 31, God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. It was evening, it was morning, the sixth day. God created everything, and then he stepped back and he went, yeah, it's all right. I give that about a 7 out of 10. Yeah, I could have maybe done that little thing a little. No. The word very good means very good. We don't have to go into the ancient languages to understand it, right? It's good. Everything that God created was exactly as he intended. Every little bit perfect. If the Creator God can look at us and say, that is very good, that means we have a high value. So we see that in the fact that God created man in his own image. Secondly, we see the high value of mankind in the fact that God is intimately involved in the creation of man. Go to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 1, again, just to make sure you understand this, you have this big, big view of creation. You're flying over it at 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 feet. And you know, you look down from that height. You know, I had the privilege of flying to Italy a couple times in a past career. And we would fly over the mountains there in Europe. And you know what? They didn't look so big. They weren't that big of a deal. But when I landed and I looked out and I saw them, I'm like, ooh. Genesis chapter 1, you're up in the plane. Genesis chapter 2, you're on the grounds. And you're looking at one specific event, and that's the creation of man. Genesis chapter 2. Look at verse 5. It says, when no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, and the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, there was no man to work the ground. Mist, verse 6, was going up from the land, was watering the whole face of the ground. Verse 7, then the Lord God formed the man of dust from the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature. Remember the pattern in Genesis chapter 1. God said, I need light. Let there be light. There is light. God said, I need to have sun and moon and stars. And all of a sudden, there's sun and moon and stars. That's how creation went. We get to the creation of man, and it's very different. This shows the value God places on us. You know, in my time in the factory, you know what? There were certain customers that I valued very, very much. And there were times that I would come out of the office, I would step down onto the floor, and I would work on those products myself because I knew what I needed, and I just wanted to be there because I valued that relationship. That's what God is doing in Genesis 2. God steps out of the heavens, he steps into creation, and it says that he formed man out of the dirt of the ground. That word form is the same word that is used to describe how the potter takes that lump of clay, he puts it on a spinning wheel, he spins it around, and he gets his hands wet, and he starts to form that into a vase, or to a bowl, or something of great worth. We watch those videos, or we see it live, and at the end, we're always looking at the vase, right? Oh, that's so beautiful. Have you ever looked at the potter's hands? Guess what? They're dirty. Why? Because he didn't just sit back and say, I want a vase. He got his hands intimately involved in the dirt, in the clay, and he formed that vessel. That's what God did for us when he formed mankind. He was intimately involved in the creation of mankind. But you know what? He takes it a step farther. Again, to show us how valuable we are. Turn to Psalm 139. It's on page 311, or 331 in your pew Bible. We read Psalm 139 this morning as we began our service. I want to go back and pick up a couple of those verses. Remember what we read. This is a God that we're dealing with who is much bigger than anything that we can imagine. In 139, Psalmist says, Lord, you search me, you know me. You know when I sit down, you know when I get up. You discern my thoughts. Even before I think about what I'm going to think about, you've already thought about it. That's how far in front of us God is. He protects us. There's no place that we can go where we are not visible and present with God, which, again, is very comforting, just a little bit scary. Because some of the places I go sometimes, I probably shouldn't. But God is with us. This is who God is. He is almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-everything. And yet, look at verse 13 again. It says, "You, God, formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it well." 15, "My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them." Now again, understand, this is a poetic passage. You don't want to always take poetry and symbolism and pull doctrine out of it. But there's a reason why God uses symbolism and poetry in the Bible. It's to help us understand something we couldn't possibly understand. And so he gives us just, you know, nuclear fission. Well, it's kind of like, I can't even tell you what it's kind of like. God is saying, listen, when you were created, it's kind of like, you know, you were in the dark and I was there putting the model together and I was putting your skeleton together and I built a framework around the skin goes on and I'm intimately involved in every little detail. We don't do that with something that's just mass produced, right? Put it in a mold, we slap it together, we ship it off. That's not what God did. God is intimately involved in every human life. And then really, catch verse 16 again. It says, "Your eyes saw me. You saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them." God values each and every life so much that he knows what my tomorrow is going to be like. He knows what Tuesday is going to bring for you. He knows what's going to happen in a year or two or three or 1,000 or however many. And it's not just this, you know, vague knowledge, well, you know, this spring break we're going to go down to South Carolina and visit family. It's not that. It's details. Why? Because of the value. He cares. You know, you come to me, you tell me, hey, I'm going to go out of town next week, and hey, that's great. Leaving on Saturday, coming back on Sunday. Hey, good luck to you. Hope it goes well. My wife's out of town this weekend with Dan visiting college out in Philadelphia. Oh boy. I'm not old enough for that. But you know what? She left at 11:30. She arrived at her hotel at this time and she texted me and she went to Outback without me. So what kind of a knucklehead goes to Outback and orders chicken? That's what they did. I know all the intimate details of what's going on, and you would do the same thing. Why? Because I value my wife and my son, my credit card. I value them very much, and so I'm absorbed with the details of their life. That's God. He is absorbed with the details of who we are. That's why he tells us, you know what? Are you hurting? Come talk to me. Are you struggling with something? Yeah, I know about it, but let's talk. God cares so much. All of these passages point to the fact that there is a very high value on us. Now, one of the key arguments that is thrown out there when we begin to talk about abortion is the fact that, well, we're not really talking about life. We're talking about a little blob of tissue. I believe in Psalm 139 argues distinctly and successfully against that argument. We are more than just a blob. We are life. If you look at the scientific evidence behind life, I think you would find the same thing if you can look at it with a very clear mind. Let me just give you a couple of bullet points really quick. At the moment, the egg and the sperm come together, before it's even implanted on the uterine wall, guess what? Boy, girl, it's already decided. Already decided. 19 days after conception, the eyes are already beginning to develop. 24 days after, the heart is already beginning to beat on its own. 30 days, that unborn baby, quarter of an inch long, brain, eyes, ears, mouth, kidney, liver. We have lives. We have fewer parts than that today. 35 days, the fingers have already formed. At 40 days, brain waves can be recorded. That's a crazy thought to me. 7th week, baby begins to move spontaneously. 10th week, the baby squints and swallows and hiccups. And at 10 weeks, that baby has fingerprints that are unique to that child. In the 12th week, the baby responds to touch. He has to suck his thumb, which goes on for years or so. By the 17th week, his ears are functioning. He can hear his mother's voice. This is the time that Tim started walking up to Melissa's womb saying, "Go Steelers, go." When I snuck over there and said, "Bear down, Chicago." 22nd week. A lady saw me out about halfway through pregnancy, 22 weeks, roughly. That baby can survive outside of the womb. Not just occasionally, but routinely, with the right medical help, that blob of tissue can live on its own without. In the 7th month, that child can now see and hear, taste and touch. The senses are all there. He recognizes his mother's voice and hopefully his father's as well. Of course, during the 9th month, 6 to 9 pounds or greater, heart is pumping 300 gallons of blood per day. I can't imagine. Fully capable of life outside them. You look at these bullet points, and I say, how can anyone say anything other than this is life? I don't get it. And yet, at almost any of those weeks, a decision can be made, appointment can be scheduled, and that life can be terminated. Really ironical here. 38 states have what's called a fetal homicide law, which means that if a pregnant woman has some kind of crime enacted against her, abuse or assault or whatever, and that child dies in the womb, that person can be charged with murder. We don't normally charge a person who's hurt a mass of tissue with murder. In 23 of those states, it goes all the way back to the very point of conception. Biblically, scientifically, legally, we're dealing with an argument that would say that this is life. Let me just give you one more reason why I think God places a high value on life, and that's the example that we see in Jesus Christ. We're not going to look at any one passage, but just review with me very quickly the Gospels. Christ, God in the flesh, Creator becoming creation, walked among us, healed the sick, gave sight to the blind, gave hearing to the deaf, helped the lame to walk again, brought life to the dead, fed the hungry and the poor, touched the lepers and those who were outcast in society. All of these things show that Christ valued human life much more than we do today. And of course, Second Corinthians 5:21, we read, "He who knew no sin became sin for us." The ultimate example of how valuable your life is the fact that someone, well, not just anyone, God Himself was willing to die so that you could live. If that does not give us value, I don't know what does. We were weak, defenseless, without any hope unless somebody stepped in. And friends, we call ourselves Christians, right? Which means little Christ. We call ourselves Christians and we're made in the image of God and we're representing God to this world. Guess what? We've got to be willing to stand up and speak for the weak and the helpless and the defenseless. And that's why we talk about these things today. We can't claim to be Christians and remain silent. And that includes the issue of abortion, human trafficking, sexual abuse, physical abuse, euthanasia, suicide, mercy killings, whatever you want to call that. From conception to the grave, every life matters. Christ did not discriminate based on age or gender or position, status, none of that. He died for all, so that all could live. And in response to that, let me just quickly give you a couple of things that we need to do. Number one, we must continue to affirm the sanctity and value of life at every stage. That's getting harder and harder to do because, again, what the Bible says is very contrary to what the world says. I really wish I could just take you to book, chapter, verse, and read, "Thou shalt not do abortions." But it doesn't say that. I think there's ample evidence to show the value that every human life has. We need to stand up and proclaim that value every opportunity we get. I'm not saying we go protest and picket, because quite honestly, that doesn't work. But we need to be vocal. In love, we share the truth. Secondly, we need to continue to work for healing. One of the risks with a sermon like this is the fact that there's probably four groups of people here today. First group are made up of those who are, you know, they've been, yeah, amen, brother, all the way through this. They agree that abortion is wrong. And it's not a challenge to them today. In fact, hopefully, if you're in that group, you're encouraged in your belief and your understanding, and you're ready to be vocal. Second group of people are those who are pro-choice. And if you're here and you're that, I'm not judging, I'm not condemning, I'm just saying this. This is what God's Word says, not me. God's Word says this, and I want to challenge you. Do your research. Open mind as you go into it, but really dig into it and understand God's value of human life. Third group of people would be those who, you know what, uncertain? Same challenge for you. No. Know what you believe and why you believe it, so that when you are asked those questions, you can share it. Then there's a potential fourth group with us today. That might be a family or a couple or an individual who has walked through the abortion scenario. I am not standing up here telling you that if you've had an abortion, you're the worst person that's ever lived. I think I still hold that record, at least in this church. We talked in our class this morning, Sunday school, about, you know, can you be not innocent but not guilty at the same time? Yeah? We struggle with that. And here's kind of where I'm going, and I still haven't worked this out. So please, you know, turn off your tape recorders. Don't hold this against me. We have a generation that is being raised to think that what is wrong is right and right is wrong. And they're confused and their mind is clouded. And they're doing things. Yes, it's wrong. It's sin. But they don't know any better. Because no one has come alongside them and say, well, hold up. This is what God says. I don't know how God will judge the generation that is in that situation, but here's what I do know. Every sin, regardless of what it is, abortion, euthanasia, suicide, hate, lying, stealing, disobeying parents, I'm sure we get that one in there. Every sin separates us from God. Consequences differ, but every sin, no matter how small we want it to be or how we want to color it, is a sin that separates us from God. And there's only one thing that restores that relationship, and that is forgiveness. And the same God who forgives adultery and abuse and addiction, forgives abortion and lying and all of these other sins. The same God who died for me and my sin and offers me forgiveness because of his love. Not because I deserve it, not because I've earned it, and certainly not because I can ever pay it back. He offers that same forgiveness to everyone. And so we have to really promote healing as we go forward. Next, we must pray. Pray that we don't have the strength, the courage to stand up. Again, not to beat people down. I'm so tired of being portrayed as the Westboro. That's not who we are. That is not who Christ was. Christ went to the people who were the outcasts of society. He went to them. He died for them. He lived for them. We should do the same. That comes through a lot of prayer, a lot of strength and confidence in who God is. I believe that the Bible lays out very clearly every life, no matter how old, how young, how perfect, or how messed up, matters immensely. Matters so much, Christ was willing to die for that life. Let's just close in prayer as our praise team comes. Father God, I thank you for your love. I don't understand it many days. I struggle to accept it sometimes. But I am so thankful that you loved us so much that you came and died so that we could know you. Lord, I pray for healing in our nation. I pray for healing in our world, that we would get to the point again where we look at things and we say that right is right and wrong is wrong and not the other way around. And we are just very much aware of following you. And Lord, I fear that we're going the other direction. But I know that there will be a day when you've returned that all that is wrong will be made right. So Father, as your church, give us, first of all, the confidence and the courage that we need as we follow you. Help us to call truth, truth. God, give us your love so that we would do it in such a way that your word is what brings change, not our words. Help us, Lord, to be very focused on restoration and reconciliation as opposed to our own warped view of justice. God, give us the desire to be your hands and feet, that we would bring loving to this world, that we would bring your grace and your mercy, your presence to those in our world who are hurting so very much. Father, help us to lean on you for strength in the days to come. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand? Thank you. member of the church, I encourage you to be here. If you're interested in being a member of the church, you really want to see how family works, come see a family meeting, come, you'll be pleasantly surprised, I think. Also, we will be starting a new FBC 101 class in February. This is for those who do want to become a member, or those who just want to find out a little bit more information about what we as a church are all about. So if you are interested in that, let me know, let Terry know, or Galen know, those are my membership guys, and we'll get you hooked up with that class. Hey, guess what? Monday comes tomorrow. But that's okay. God's on our side. We can go out the way confident in who He is. Let's just pray as we close. Father God, hey, we thank You so much. We don't have to be afraid. We don't have to fear the things of this world. We know that You are on our side. Lord, I love You and I thank You for Your love for us. Help us this week as we go out that we would be very bold in our confidence in You, not in ourselves. That we would go where You would have us to go, speak to those that You would have us to speak, to touch and to heal those who so desperately need the hands and feet of Christ. Keep us safe, but as always, Lord, keep us in Your will. Keep us relying in You. We ask all of this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day.